Hello, multi-morbid monoblocks. I'm Ralphy. Welcome to Ralphy Review 652, and welcome to the final part, the malt mark, of Ralphy Review 651. I did a terrible thing, malt mates, a terrible thing, but before I go any further, a malt mention. Thank you to Raymond. Thank you, Raymond, for your malt mention. It's now mentioned. Now, having mentioned the malt mention, it's time to mention the malt mark from the previous review, which I forgot to give. I did. Ralphy Review 651, 14-year-old Glengoyne from Marks and Spencer's, 87 out of 100. It's a malt mark. Phew, I'm glad I've got that out of the way. Righto. Now for a change of scenery. Got a new home for this. This is a Panama hat. I'm not reviewing whiskey, you see, in this review. I'm reviewing rum. So I've changed my hat, and I've done it now because I've done so in the past. It's a tradition, malt mates. Not a very old tradition, but it's one that I've decided to stick with because I quite like it. Here comes the rum. Do you recognise any of these rums? If you do, if it's available near where you are, you lucky rum person. This is Killdevil Hampden Rum from Jamaica. This is Villiers Foursquare Rum from Barbados. And this is a very recent addition to what's available in Europe. From Brazil, it's cachaça. Cachaça is an indigenous form of rum. People who are into cachaça will never call it rum, but it is very similar. It really is. This is highly unusual in that it has been matured in native woods which are not oak. And in my opinion, that makes it very interesting, in particular in relation to its quality. It's tasty. It's a different taste, you see, and it's tasty stuff. But one rum at a time, malt mates. I just thought I'd introduce these other two before I concentrate in reviewing this one. It's true what they say. A change is as good as a rest. It's also true what they say when they say that it's very easy to get into palate habits, nosing habits, tasting habits, drinking habits, the company you keep habits, the music you listen to habits. And it's, you need a reason now and again, we all need a reason to refresh our sense of smell and taste with something which is completely different to what we normally consume. For you and I, it's generally whiskey because I'm primarily a whiskey reviewer. But I do like to check out other spirits on a fairly regular basis. And at this moment in time, in May 2017, there's interesting things happening in the rum world. We're really seeing independent bottlers, European-based independent bottlers in particular, latching on to the fact that there is a growing demand for high-quality sipping whiskies, the single-cask stuff, the higher-strength stuff, the unsugared stuff, the rum that is not being produced as a mixing ingredient with cocktails and long drinks. The sort of rums that you'll get distinctive smells from, distinctive tastes from, that you really don't encounter with whiskies. And this is a great place to start. A number of years ago, yep, I do hang on to some bottles for quite a number of years. Some Ralphy veterans will recognise this popping up, what, 5 years ago? I bought this bottle of Jamaican rum from Scottish independent bottlers Murray McDavid, and I was curious because this rum had been matured in part in port casks. Now, this has become quite a habit for maturing whiskey, or double casking, or additional maturation, or secondary maturation, call it what you want. A lot of that's happening with Scotch single malt whiskies now. But here, it was happening with some rum, and the rum was Hampden, and I got a bit of a taste for it. I like the distinctive character of it. Now, this one was bottled in 2005. So it's been around quite a long time. You'll notice this electric tape round the top, which is the sign that I've put some carbon dioxide argon gas preserver in that bottle to stop the rum oxidizing. And when I've opened it up and had a smell, I really notice how well that private preserve gas has worked. When you're nosing a bottle, by the way, stick your top, your thumbnail over the top so as your nose doesn't actually touch the top of the bottle and leave traces of snotters, right, on the bottle, because it's very off-putting for other people that are going to get a glass. Okay. This is very estuary rum, but I notice it's also very fruity as well. But it's with more experience with other versions of Hampden that I now notice, although this is a good version of rum, it was in fairly inert casks and they were beefing it up with a port finish. That is more evident now, because this particular version, with which I can use as a direct comparison, is 16 years old, bottled at 46%, and it's a single cask rum. Lovely stuff. As you can see, a distinctly natural colour. And most likely, unchill filtered. As soon as you put your nose to it, overripe bananas, overripe everything, very estuary, like really intense pineapple cube confectionery. It's a bit overwhelming, it's a bit overpowering, and one thing's for sure, malt mates, you ain't going to smell anything like this in a Scotch single malt whiskey. This is a whole different flavour profile. Not only that, when you add a drop of water, when you let it settle down, when you taste it, you're getting a different form, you're getting a different delivery profile. And it's very refreshing for the palate, actually, because you notice you're thinking about things more because you don't have your usual terms of reference in terms of smell and taste that you have with single malt or blended whiskey. It's beginning to settle down in the glass now. There's more fresh strawberry notes, wild strawberries, that have got that slightly solventy, pleasant solventy smell to them. So I'm adding not a lot of water, just a little, to tone down the excessiveness of that ester. Are you going to love it or are you going to loathe it? I don't think there's many people going to be having a very neutral opinion about this. If you like your heavy flavoured whiskies, this is a good rum to start with. Jamaica produces some of the most intensely flavoured, distinctive rums in the world. Generally, there's nothing particularly subtle about them. And probably a good place to start in terms of availability is Ray and Nephew's Overproof Rum, bottled at 62%. It's big. It's huge. It's really the rum equivalent of a Laphroaig. All right, little swirly swirl in the glass, nice and gentle. Creamy, so much more creamy. It's sweet, but there's a sourness there. there's a little bit of overripe fruit, bitter sour, something slightly acetic, pleasantly acetic. The nose is most definitely sweet, but it's not cloyingly sweet. Overripe bananas again. Guavas, most definitely overripe mangoes that are just beginning to ferment because they've been left in the sun too long. That's there. Pineapple, super ripe pineapple. If you're ever in the tropics, you will soon discover that there's whole different varieties of pineapple. But there's really just the one variety that's commercially produced by the corporate multinationals. And that's how we define the taste of pineapple, through commercially grown pineapples of a certain shape and a certain size. But when you go into the tropics, at the local fruit market, you discover tiny little pineapples, tiny little bananas, tiny little other little fruits, which the smaller the fruits get, the more intense the flavour becomes. Ask if you're in the tropics, you know what I mean. And over time, there's this developing soft, beautiful, spicy, slightly icing sugared note, which is beautiful, soft, but intense. It's hard to pin it down. It's part spice, part almost marzipan. Taste-wise, oh, it's a big attack. Boom, quite spirity, but palatable spirity. The spirit is intense, very cleaning on the palate. The initial sweetness very quickly disappears. There's a ripe fruit bitterness, which is a kind of contrary description. It's a conflicting description to make, to describe fruit as bitter. But if you can imagine overripe fruit mixed with underripe fruit put together and then left to ferment a bit, you've got that underripe bitterness and that overripe super sweetness coming together and moulding into one event. And you get that in the palate and the development. So the arrival for this rum, very clean on the palate, sweet, overripe bananas dominates, some soft ginger, icing sugar, vanilla, honey. The development comes that sweet and sour, underripe fruit, overripe fruit. Very estery. Hugely estery. A lot of things that you would recognise in industrially produced cheap confectionery from your childhood. Cola cubes, classic example. Jargonelle pear drops, another great example. The finish is really sort of overcoated with that intense sweet and sour distinctive character, but within it there's a little bit of lime juice, a little bit of mintiness, fresh garden apple mint, and again the little soft notes of honey. Not European honey, by the way. We're talking desert honey, tropical honey. Honey from the tropics has a different flavour. It's difficult to describe, but if you can experience it, you would know exactly what I was referring to. This is a fabulous rum if you're a whiskey drinker and you want something that is oh so different, that is not your commonly heavily blended, almost sanitized version of rum, something that's a challenge. This is a great place to start. You will find Hampden rum available from a number of independent bottlers. I've bought the Killdevil one because it's a fairly recent addition to the rum scene in terms of being an independent bottling. it's available where I am, and I really like the fact that it's an older, matured rum. Rum, because it's matured generally in equatorial zones in the tropics, the alcoholic losses are much higher than they are with Scotch whisky, which is matured in the Northern Hemisphere. This is a complex thing, more complex than it appears, and I'm going to cover this subject later on in my rum reviews. But for the moment, what I would say is that the age statements appearing in single cask rums are actually more affordable options than the same age statements on single cask whiskies at the moment. So if you know your whiskies, you're into your whiskies, and you're looking for a tangible, distinctive change, this is the fella for you. There's other independent bottlers. Cadenheads in Scotland are independent bottlers, but you've got quite a number of rum independent bottlers around the world, so search them out wherever you are. You may be surprised at some of the little treasures that you find in your journey. This certainly benefits from being bottled at a higher strength. It is simply delivering more intensity of flavour, and that really helps you to get your bearings and examining the smell and taste of this rum. So a wee note to official bottlers of rum: bring out your single casks, but make sure you up the strength. Look at what whiskey producers do and copy that, because there is definitely a growing, significantly growing global market for sipping rums. And it's interesting to note that that the main providers who understand that market and are catering for that market are the independent bottlers. My next review of Foursquare from Villiers is an absolute classic example of this situation. But before we go any further, and before I forget again, how about a rum mark? Right, I've got to get the whiskey cards out the way. Where is it? Where's the rum one? It's in here somewhere. I haven't used it for a while, so it'll be now near the back. It'll be behind, there it is, right behind rye and bourbon. Rum. What rum mark am I going to give this? For its hugely distinctive character. For the fact that it is as far away from whiskey flavours as you can possibly get. I cannot think of any whiskey equivalent to this particular flavour. Initially, you'll find it really quite overwhelming, but bear with it. Add a little water. Importantly, it's been 16 years in the cask. Give it 16 minutes in the glass, and you will be well rewarded with, here we go, 88 out of 100. It's a rum mark for Killdevil single cask Jamaican rum from Hampden Distillery. And by the way, just so as you know, when I was lifting the bottle out the container, because I bought it online, it was wrapped in bubble wrap, little mini bubble wrap, to keep it from rattling around inside the box and potentially damaging the label. Well, it was overwrapped, and it was rather tight in the box. When I pulled it out, I ripped the label. So that explains, in case you're wondering what the defacing is. There we go. The label, frankly, is a little bit dull, a little bit dreary. It looks like a kind of postage stamp, a kind of old-fashioned, dull postage stamp. Personally, I think, as a Northern European, I like to see lots of colour on a rum label. I like to see sunshine and pirate ships and all the rest of it. I know it's a little bit cliche, but it really sets gets me in the mood for the experience of what's in the bottle. The label can be very much an ambassador for the content. Although I know that in tropical countries, they think it's a little bit cliched. But there we go. Personal opinion. I'm Ralphie. That's me completed my rum review. What am I going to do next? How am I going to finish? Well, here's a bottle that I opened many years ago and I didn't finish it. I kept it for a reason. It had been double matured, this version of Hampden, in a port cask. And now I've bought another bottle of Hampden, two bottles of Hampden. Can you blend them together? Just a wee drop, not a big drop. Does it make a difference? Just like you blend different age statement, different generations of Scotch single malts? Yeah, it certainly does. This is much, just adding a wee drop of this has given it a fresh fruit note that wasn't there before. Slightly rhubarb. The solventiness is really diminishing in the nose. Really quite interesting. Fascinating. So if you do buy a bottle of rum, don't forget to share that with your friends and encourage them to buy a bottle so you can make a wee night of it. Try the different varieties. And importantly, if you get two rums from the same distillery, just like with whiskey, you will learn so much when you start to blend your own. And the final result is, of course, when you have your own specific, singular, unique bottle of rum as part of your whiskey collection or your growing rum collection, and it's your own blended rum from all around the world. And beside that bottle, you have a little cheap globe, light-up globe. And every time you add a drop of the rum, you go to the location on the globe and you mark it and you date it. And it becomes a fascinating travelogue timeline to your journey with rum. I'm Ralphie. I've finished this review. I'm going to have one final sip of this rum and then I am going to do my research with this rum and this cachaça in preparation for my forthcoming rum reviews. There's a whole new flavour note crept into there. Toffee. In the development going into the finish, there's a distinctive, slightly rose-hipped, fructose toffee note. Interesting. Bye-bye.